Hey folks, this is Best in Slot, and welcome back to our daily review and discussion of Prehistoric Planet. We're on to episode 4 today, only one left after today, very sad. But on the plus side, Ice Worlds may have been the best episode yet. It's definitely vying for number one spot with Deserts for me personally, and it actually directly addresses quite a few of the criticisms I had of yesterday's freshwater episode. So, really excited to discuss this one. Let me know what you thought in the comment section down below. And let's get started. So opening up here in the nighttime of North America with this unnamed dromaeosaur. Now I don't know this for sure, but there is a Alaskan dromaeosaur specimen DMNH21183 who's as of right now currently unnamed because it's only known from a jaw fragment, so it hasn't been named, it hasn't been properly gone through. That is going to be a fairly common occurrence throughout this episode, so that the species is quite simply not named whatsoever. Now this is kind of an assumption on my part, but I'm assuming that's because there's a lot of fragmentary evidence for these dinosaurs, and I'm assuming that's because, well, basically the better a dinosaur is buried, the better the fossil preservation will be. Kind of like that Borealopelter who got properly, you know, dug under the river and all of that, and it was marvelously preserved. I'm assuming because of the frozen environment then, that a body being buried would actually be quite a hard thing to do, right? Because the ground is so hard. So maybe that's why so few Arctic and Antarctic etc. dinosaurs have been fully preserved. Anyway, so we have an unnamed dromaeosaur, so she's absolutely beautiful. She's got some really cool extra little details that you can't see quite here. And the feathers here make a lot of sense as well. You know, she's keeping feathers for warmth more than anything else. She's got that strong white underbelly, that counter shading, I talk about it quite a lot, but it's basically having a light underbelly and a dark upper belly back, basically, because then when the sun hits you, it sort of evens you out, essentially. And I imagine animals that have very strong counter shading, you can see the delineation here between the white and the dark is very, very strong. It's maybe because when the sun does hit, it's particularly harsh, and therefore it would need to be stronger coloration to counter that. There's some guesswork there for me. But anyways, she looks absolutely marvelous. I mean, look at the feather work here just above the eye, and the way the eye movement and the animation on it is absolutely superb. I just wanted to point that out. She hunts down an insect, so we're seeing yet more insectivore behavior from our dinosaurs after the Mononychus previously. And then we shift over a little bit to daytime and we meet our hadrosaurs. Now they're just called hadrosaurs in the show. However, we're all pretty sure it's Edmontosaurus, and I'm pretty sure that the official website, the Prehistoric Planet website itself, calls them Edmontosaurus. We've been calling these Edmontosaurus for ages, and it also makes sense given the environment. So I'm assuming they are Edmontosaurus. I'm not sure why they weren't named. I do really like the patterning of them though. They've got this tricolor sort of effect. Someone mentioned in my last video that a lot of the dinosaurs are red, and it's true. A lot of the dinosaurs are red, and again, you'll see it consistently throughout this episode. Red and teal is a fairly, the two most common colors by a fairly dramatic margin, I would suggest. But we have our lovely uncrested hadrosaur here, massive chonky duck bill, really, really interesting, one of the more varied and interesting patternings we've had in the entire show. And do want to shout out for the general direction and photography on display here. The nature photography for this section is absolutely remarkable and is consistently remarkable throughout the entire episode. It really is the best episode for that sort of thing. But anyway, so the Edmontosaurus, I'm just gonna call them Edmontosaurus. The Edmontosaurus want to cross this dangerous river. You know, it's flooded, it's dangerous, it's icy, it's at least using the environment. They're crossing this dangerous river, and unfortunately most of them make it. They panic a little bit, which is going to be a recurring theme, and they kind of sprint across the river, and most of them make it. Unfortunately, this younger one doesn't quite make it, and we can see here the size differentiation between the dromaeosaur and the Edmontosaurus juvenile. But this is what I want to talk about. So first of all, we can finally see the dromaeosaur in all this detail, and again, she's got that teal coloring that I just mentioned. We've got a tail fan, which is really beautiful looking there, and a completely different shade of blue, which is really interesting. So clearly kind of suggesting a display purpose. But then we also have, as you can see here, these extra little wing tips on the very end. Now these don't serve, as far as I'm aware, a hunting advantage or anything like that. They are purely a display thing. So I was curious as to whether there's any evidence for that in dinosaurs. And I couldn't find any directly for non-avian dinosaurs, but I did find a 2021 paper just last year by Wang et al., which was on an early Cretaceous bird. So prior to this dromaeosaur, this early Cretaceous, called Juan Chavez, which had a huge long pintail, basically, which would have, and it was like twice the size of its body, so it would have been just for display purposes. It doesn't serve a hunting or survival function. It's there's the paper on it, or one of the articles on it mentioned, it's no longer survival of the fittest, it's survival of the sexiest. And that definitely appears to be a thing. But that's really interesting, and again, it's something I would be surprised if it didn't make its way into Dinosaurs at all. Spring Wharf brings Islands of Silt, as they say, and we get to see the Ornithomimus, which wasn't mentioned at all in the teasers or trailers, which is really exciting. So it's a brand new surprise dinosaur with a fantastic mohawk. As you can see, once again, those feathered dinosaurs emerging, looking absolutely beautiful. Probably my favorite second favorite species design of the entire episode. It looks absolutely fantastic. You can see the mohawk here, and there you can see the whole body. Again, we've got those red feathers, which is just what I was on about, but mainly gray, mainly sort of tame coloring, and then a burst of color somewhere, which is definitely a theme amongst quite a lot of these, particularly the feathered dinosaurs. But it's a fantastic scene wherein the Ornithomimus, or one of them, has arrived late to this big nesting area. He's trying to steal material for his nest because the best nest is going to attract the best mate. And it's very much played up for humor, the Ornithomimus sort of sneaking up. Did you ever play Knock-A-Door? Not Knock-A-Door Run. What's the time, Mr. Wolf? Where you had to, I'm sure you all called it different things, but you had to walk up behind someone, and if they turned around, you had to stop. It's exactly like that. It's very much played up for the humor, and it is very, very effective. Again, they're just infused with so much personality. The main one is very, very sneaky. The other one's sort of suspicious and watchful. And that stealing off nest material is a very common behavior in modern birds. So it makes a lot of sense that our more bird-like dinosaurs would engage in the same thing. Jays in particular do it, but tons and tons and tons of species of birds do the exact same thing. The episode even ends, funnily, where these the hadrosaurs, the Edmontosaurus from earlier, walks past, so we can see some nice gender dimorphism here in the coloration. You assume it's the male on the left. And wanting to protect the nest, the Ornithomimus kind of squares up and flaps the wings a little bit. Like, yo, it's my nest, bro, back off. And the Edmontosaurus, he just kind of turns to it, just come on, what are you doing? Just walks away. Next, we move on to Russia and our Aloro Titan with this lovely coloured head crest. They're very similar, the two Aloro Titans. I'm going to show you another one, right? So just look at this one and then look at this one. You can see the difference is really in the crest. I'm going to assume this might be the male because the crest is larger, I believe. And obviously, again, red coloration, teal coloration. I'm not making this up. It is a very consistent design philosophy. But yeah, so we can see a bit of gender dimorphism there. But this was really interesting. So I'm assuming we're in Russia because that's where Aloro Titan's from. And we're venturing over these majestic landscapes. It's all beautiful. Music's epic as per usual. And music's really building up this epic journey across this harsh landscape. And what they're trying to do is get to this volcanic region. Super dangerous volcanic region as well. But the reason given is that they're going to nest in this volcanic region. They're going to bury their eggs under the volcanic dirt, basically, and then the natural heat in the area is going to act as an incubator for the eggs. So I looked into this to find if it was behavior seen in anything else. Now, obviously, quite a few animals do bury their eggs, and we think most dinosaurs buried their eggs, but specifically in the volcanoes, there is a type of bird called the megapodes, which is a fantastic name. I mean, it means big feet, but it sounds amazing. otherwise known as incubator birds, and they would bury their eggs in volcanic sand because the volcanic sand was a lot hotter and it would heat up their eggs and it would act as an incubator, whereas, you know, other birds would sit on their eggs to heat them up that way, as you see chickens, etc. So I just thought that was a really interesting, pretty cool behavior. And the babies, the little baby Aloro Titans. This whole segment, by the way, was fantastic, and it's one of the things this episode does better. All the segments got a little bit more time to breathe. The episode was like 3 minutes longer than yesterday's, and it just felt like we got more time with each dinosaur. Yeah, every segment kind of got a little bit more time to breathe. I do wish the whole thing was maybe 10 minutes longer and every segment got like 2 or 3 more minutes. I think that would have been perfect. But the Aloro Titan babies are the cutest thing in the world. They really are. They broke my heart. Teeny tiny little squishy things, and they're flopping around and playing with each other. This really joyful, happy behavior. And as per usual, when you see a joyful, happy behavior, it's because the show wants to play with the tone of the whole thing. And it does indeed. We get this lovely shot of them feasting. Basically, they're here. The spring and summer has arrived. They've got these horsetails that they can feast on and get all these nutrients. But we get a shot from the water, and it is, I mean, right there, that is framed exactly like a horror film. That's framed like Jaws or Lake Placid, which is a fantastic film. Something like that. There's something lurking beneath the water. And I wasn't sure what it would be. I was expecting a marine reptile. Well, not like a pond reptile of some description or something like that. But you sink down, and what it actually is just gaggles, 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 billions of mosquitoes. And they're swarming all over the place, and again, it's kind of disgusting, I'm not gonna lie. They're all over them, like covering their eyes. You can barely see the eyes of the dinosaurs behind the swarm of mosquitoes that's gathered on top of them. The babies, which are obviously much smaller and more susceptible to this, are getting covered and drained of blood. And it mentions how these hadrosaurs have quite thin skin, so the blood's easy to get to. All these mosquitoes, female mosquitoes, by the way, I think it's only female mosquitoes that drain blood. Correct me if I'm wrong. At least in the more common species. Anyways, they're getting drained, they're getting ruined. Jurassic Park would have a field day, but for the hadrosaurs, it's a terrible, terrible thing. And it mentions, okay, these are, it's funny, there's always this dichotomy of how the parents, the great parents, they traveled all this way to give their babies the best start in life, to incubate them in these lovely sands, and they're off away from most predators you'd assume in this area. So to an extent, they've got a good life, and the babies will go with them for the first year or something. On the other hand, it mentions how, because they go to higher ground to get away from the mosquitoes, and the baby is getting absolutely ravaged by it. It's so upsetting to watch after we've just seen them be so playful and happy. And it mentions, well, if the baby falls behind, the baby falls behind, and it's kind of left for dead. Until the triumphant moment when it emerges over the cliff top, and rejoins with its mother in a joyous manner, and it's framed again so epically. It's like the end of Lord of the Rings or something. It's Sam dragging an imaginary Frodo up the hill, and it's a lovely moment. It's quite a happy episode, I would say, generally speaking. Now, onto what is probably my favourite segment in terms of the interesting behaviour. In North America, forest fires are ravaging the area, and we get ourselves an unnamed troodontid. This I can understand. Troodon itself is a tooth, essentially. It's a tooth taxon. Troodontids in this area, they're very, very, very fragmentary. Everything's very up in the air in that regard with the troodontids, so I can see why it's just called a troodontid. But she is an absolute beauty. I am in love with her. She's got those massive eyes to help her see. You know, we've seen the huge eye gouge, the feathers sort of splaying off on the back of the head there. She's got a dramatic tail fan there. She's got the wings splaying out like that. She just looks absolutely majestic and beautiful, and I love her deeply. And she does two really interesting behaviors. So the first one we're seeing here, she's basically waiting around the edge of the fire for prey animals to escape from the flames so she can hunt them. And this is a behavior seen quite a lot in modern animals. Bears do it. What else does it? I have a list. Badgers do it, I believe. Raccoons, not badgers. Raccoons, maybe badgers do. Bears, raccoons, but most importantly, raptors, modern birds of prey, will also engage in the same behavior. They'll wait near the edges of forest fires, all the prey skitters out, and they'll hunt them. So this is definitely a logical behavior for a troodontid to do, especially given troodontids were very intelligent hunters. But it actually gets more interesting. You see here there's a burning stick in the bottom left, and she's kind of walking up to it, observing it. And what she does is she picks it up, brings it around to like a nest area where these small creatures are hiding, and she drops it on the ground to incite a flame. And I thought, okay, that's maybe a step too far. That seemed quite speculative to me, and it is speculative as to whether troodontid did this, but I looked into it, and there's a 2017 paper by Bonta et al. Which mentions that this is a behavior observed in Australia by people in the Northern Territories, by Aboriginal people, etc., etc., and they've been observing it for a really long time, and they see it in falcons and kites, where they would do the same thing. They would find burning sticks and use them to incite fires to drive wildlife out so they can hunt them, much in the way we talked about with that first behavior. So it's a really, really interesting behavior that does exist in modern times, and therefore could have existed in this, exists in modern dinosaurs, so why not in ancient dinosaurs, right? Especially ones that were intelligent hunters. And troodontids were. It's something like 70% of theropods in this area were troodontids of some description. They were clearly well suited and well built for hunting in this sort of environment. I just thought it was really interesting, actually. First mammal sighting, which is really exciting. Bum, bum, bum. First mammal sighting, she's a beauty. You never full on see her because of the lighting and everything, but in that lighting, she looks incredible. Always backlit and shrouded in smoke and stuff. I think she's gorgeous. I'd be very curious what the mammal is. It's clearly rodent in form. There was a mammal, I can't remember, it began with a U, I can't remember what the name was, but there was a mammal that began with U in this sort of area, but I don't know if it was the same one. It was only fairly recently discovered. But we must move on. Again, more beautiful dramatic landscape shots. The landscape photography in this episode is fantastic, and we've gone down to the Antarctic for the first time to meet ourselves Antarctopelta, which was a 13 foot or so long little ankylosaur. And it's three of them wandering through the forest looking for, you know, shelter, and they're kind of just sticking together due to they're a couple of years old, year old, something like that. And so they've still got time to grow, so they want to stick together just to keep each other a little bit more safe. Now, I need to credit here, Joshua Noop. Joshua Noop, who mentioned this on Twitter, because I wasn't aware of this. So this is, as I said, our Antarctic Pelto, but it's got fairly fragmentary evidence in the last few years. I think in 2021 it's officially done, but discovered in 2017, 2018, there was a relative, another ankylosaur called Stegaurus, S-T-E-G-O-U-R-O-S, Stegaurus. Which was found a really good preservation, and one of the things, and the general morphology was generally speaking there, but also had a really interesting tail. You can see here that our Antarctopelta is kind of like a nodosaurid, in that it doesn't have, there's just nothing on the tail whatsoever. It doesn't have a club, doesn't have anything. It's very nodosaurid in design, but the Stegaurus had like really interesting, it's like an Aztec club, trying to pronounce it because I'll butcher it, but it's like this fan of bone basically that juts out like this on both sides, so it's like a tail fan but made out of bone, and it would be a really good defensive weapon potentially. And it seems likely that Antarctopelta may have had something similar, but this was the first time it was discovered, and the paper only came out last year, so obviously there wouldn't have been time to integrate that kind of thing into the show. Anyways, it's hard to see what's going on here, but they're searching for a cave, and unfortunately they keep coming back to this cave every year, but they're getting a little bit bigger and only two of them can fit in. So the third one goes off on his own little epic journey, and it's adorable. The CGI is probably the weakest on the Antarctopelta compared to the others. I think it would be a very hard dinosaur to do. There's just a couple of shots that pulled me out of it just a little bit, but it goes on his own epic adventure and it's super cute, and he's exploring all these lands, and he's running into hadrosaurs again, unnamed hadrosaurs appearing in 4 out of 6 of the things. But look at it, like, again, it's kind of like with the Mononychus in that we've been really zoomed in, so they look small but they don't look tiny, and then you see it against the hadrosaur, you're like, oh my god, he's adorable. And he ends up finding this cave full of what are they called again, fungus gnat larvae, which use light streams to attract prey basically and then hunt them. And he, you know, he falls asleep under the stars. He finds himself a happy little cave to live in. It's adorable again. We're getting these happy endings. It's nice that the show doesn't shy away from the brutality, but it's nice to see things go well for them every now and again as well. And again, I feel like this was more like a complete story, and something this episode does fairly consistently well is show an entire story, an entire little narrative based on a dinosaur. But we move on to the Arctic and our final segment with the Pachyrhinosaurus, which looks absolutely fantastic here. I love the nasal boss in particular, this rugged, ragged, jagged kind of boss of bone atop the snout, and these kind of convex built-in almost like things here just above the boss. It has a goat eye. It's always exciting. It's nice being able to properly see the Pachyrhinosaurus, right? Because we've only seen it sort of shrouded in snow before, so we can see all this detail, all this lovely colouring and patterning. They are quilled, both. You can see just about there, it's got like more like a tail fan sort of thing, but in quills. And there's a little quilling on the upper back there. And these are all butting for dominance, fighting amongst themselves. But they hear a cry out in the distance. Nanooksaurus has appeared, looking absolutely fantastic. They look, again, beautifully feathered, love the striping down the back. I saw the concept art for this one like a few years ago, and it's been brought to life beautifully well. And basically, to have a better chance of defending themselves, the Pachyrhinosaurus head out into the open wilderness so they can kind of form their defensive circle. Again, as we see in modern animals all the time, and as people have speculated for a long time that ceratopsids would engage in. The Uncovered, you know, the extra detail video was about this, about whether dinosaurs pack hunted, basically, focused on the Nanooksaurus. And it basically mentioned, I mean, I think most of us accept quite happily now that dinosaurs would have hunted in packs, but I think the point is to kind of, again, circumvent that perspective people have of dinosaurs being stupid or unsocial and just brutal dumb monsters basically, which I think has started to go away a little bit, but I'm definitely biased because the people I hang out with would generally speaking lean in that direction anyway. But it mentions things like trackways, you know, we've got it with tyrannosaurs, it doesn't say Nanooksaurus specifically, where there's three sets of tyrannosaur prints next to each other all going in the same direction from the same time. Monospecies beds, of course, where millions of, not millions, but loads of the same dinosaurs are found together, like the coelophysis beds, for example. There's just so many of them found in one place that clearly these dinosaurs engaged in some form of pack behavior. I don't know if that's a good example, by the way, but my point is it mentions monospecies beds. And modern animals, of course, raptors engaging in pack hunting. And I just want to say, by the way, it's so nice to see... Oh, yeah, there's an Anuxosaurus in a little bit more detail because it deserves it. It's an absolute beauty. Not gone full on for that white coating. You know, I like that they've held back on that a little bit. There's sort of splays of it going on in there. But again, it's got more of that crimson sort of brownish sort of colouring on there. And they look fantastic. The hunting and just biding their time hunting these Pachyrhinosauruses. Until eventually they panic. And again, it kind of calls back, I think, maybe purposefully to the first part of this episode where the Edmontosaurus panics. And that's what causes the problems in the first place. They all kind of dart into the river and one gets left behind. And I think the lesson here is don't be stupid. Don't panic. Bide your time. Be patient. Fortunately, they all start to sprint away. The bull gets left behind and gets taken down. So we do get to see a successful hunt at the end as well, which is not a super common thing in this show. It definitely doesn't want to focus on that hunting behavior. I suppose two of the episodes so far have been hunting. Three of the segments have been about hunting, so it's not that rare. But yeah, I mean, the Nanooksaurus in the running animation as well. You should see it running. It looks fantastic. I think that's it. It's been really nice seeing a ceratopsid. I love ceratopsids. They're my favorite thing. So it's really nice to see a ceratopsid. The Pachyrhinosaurus looks absolutely fantastic. There's been a lot of theropod and pterosaur love. Now, it does have to an extent, focus on the dinosaurs that dominated the area and the time, but ceratopsids were doing well, and next episode is the Triceratops. It's also the return of the Quetzalcoatlus, and a couple other, we're going to see Corythoraptor, we're going to see Chuanjosaurus. I just say that really quickly so my pronunciation gets by. It's Chuanjiao, I think it might be Chuanjiao, something like that. I'm excited to hear Attenborough pronounce it. Either way, really good episode, had really good storylines, had tons of new dinosaurs. I love the Rex, I love the Raptor, I love the pterosaurs, but seeing the same ones kind of repeatedly is not as exciting. We want to see new species. There's been a lot of focus on the Rex and a lot of focus on the Raptor, which I get, they're the popular ones with the public, but for us dinosaur people, I guess, it's nice to see new species featured instead. Hopefully we see Therizinosaurus next episode. It's been mentioned that it's going to come back, but I didn't see it in the preview. Yeah, let me know what you thought in the comment section down below. My personal favourite of the bunch. Very excited for tomorrow, but also sad that it's going to be over. Thanks for joining me. Cheers, much love as always. Bye-bye. Reaching out.